Topic of the day, cystic neoplasm, is very interesting and often several questions are asked. So I think we can finish it soon. So it's the most common cystic lesion of pancreas?
Pseudocyst.
Very good. Most common cystic lesion is pseudocyst. Most common cystic neoplasm is mucinocystic
neoplasm.
These are all very, very, very common questions. They will not be asked. So peripheral XL calcification is seen in
mucinocystic neoplasm.
MCM.
See, this is one important picture. It's very important, and which describes the all the cystic neoplasms. This is the serous cystic neoplasm, mucinocystic neoplasm, main ductype EMN and transductype EMN. You see, the serous cystic neoplasm will have fine external lobulations, central stellate scar, central calcification. What is the most common location of serous cystic neoplasm? Head, body,
head
tail.
Of the pancreas.
Body.
Head.
Head of the pancreas.
Or evenly distributed.
Head, sir.
Head of the pancreas.
Where is it given? It is head. Where is it given?
Head is given in subistan and throughout evenly distributed.
Yeah, I will show you the reference. Okay. Then mucinocystic neoplasm, what is the most common location?
Body and tail.
Body and tail region. It is a larger cyst with peripheral calcification. You see the peripheral calcification here. Okay. And this is main duct IPMN. Main duct IPMN means you should understand IPMN. IPMN means it is only the abnormality of the duct. Branch duct IPMN presents as a cystic lesion, which communicates with the pancreatic duct. So SCN and MCN do not communicate with the pancreatic duct, whereas branch duct IPMN communicates with the pancreatic duct. The most common location of branch duct IPMN is?
Uncinate.
Very good. See, you should, when you identify a cystic lesion, like this oligocystic microcystic lesion, okay, we should then know, we should do an MRI to rule out communication with the pancreatic duct. If it is communicating, it is branch duct IPMN. Both SCN and BD IPMN, side branch IPMN, look similar. The only differentiation you can make is communication with the pancreatic duct. If it is communicating, it is a branch duct IPMN. If it is not communicating, it is a you can allow her LM. Okay. See, this is serous cystic neoplasm. What is the appearance? We call it as honeycomb appearance. Okay. What is the appearance in branch duct IPMN? What is the appearance in branch duct IPMN?
Bunch of grapes.
Bunch of grapes appearance. Very good. So, what is the age which in which serous cystic neoplasm occurs?
Grandma age.
Teenage age. And my age. Mucinocystic neoplasm?
Mother age.
Middle age.
Mother age.
IPMN, what is the age?
Old age.
Male or female? More commonly affected.
Equal.
Equal disturbance.
It's given here, but in some other references, it is males are more commonly affected. IPMN, males are more commonly affected in old age. Okay. So this is senior solid pseudopapillary tumor occurs in the daughter age. What is the other name for solid pseudopapillary tumor? Franz tumor or
hemorrhage? Franz tumor.
Mother, mucinocystic neoplasm. Old age, serous cystic neoplasm. Okay. So this is another important table about the cyst fluid characteristics in each of the tumors and the gender ratio, gross features, macroscopic features like that. You see, mucinocystic neoplasm is very, very common in the females. It contains ovarian stroma. Mucinocystic neoplasm contains ovarian stroma and estrogen receptors and progesterone receptors in the epithelial cells. So mucinocystic neoplasm is very, very common in females. It is very rare in males. Okay, all the cystic neoplasms are like serous cystic neoplasm, mucinocystic neoplasm are all common in females. Whereas IPMN is more common in males. But here it is given in 1:1, but I will show other reference. Solid pseudopapillary tumor is again more common in females. It occurs in young age. like 20-year female coming with an abdominal pain, you take an ultrasound, it shows a cystic lesion in the body and tail region of pancreas. We should suspect solid pseudocyst papillary tumor. Okay. What will be the CEA level? Should we discuss about CEA and amylase levels? You know, mucinous lesions.
Mucinous and IPM.
Mucinous lesions will have high CEA. Like MCN and IPMN will have high CEA levels. Amylase will be high in cyst, which is communicating with the pancreatic duct. It's very simple. Okay. And one point about macroscopic and microscopic features of serocystic neoplasm is they have a clear cytoplasm, well-defined border, and uniform nuclei, glycogen-rich cells. It's stained with PAS stain. Okay. Glycogen-rich cells in serocystic neoplasm. That is one important point. Okay. We will discuss each tumor in detail. Serocystic neoplasm, they have a lobulated cystic mass. They are multilocular and microcystic. They do not communicate with the pancreatic duct. And the cyst fluid is watery without mucin. See this. Fine external lobulations, central stellate scar. They are multiple, numerous cysts will be seen. Like a honeycomb appearance will be seen. And they have a cuboidal epithelium with prominent nuclei. And they are rich in glycogen. Without cellular atypia and necrosis. See this appearance, honeycomb appearance of serocystic neoplasm. Okay. So fine external lobulation, central stellate scar, central calcification with wall thickness less than 2 mm. Remember these three. Fine external lobulation, central scar, central calcification is characteristic of serocystic neoplasm. Fine external lobulations, central stellate scar, and central calcification. You can also say this appearance is spongy appearance. See the cystic lesion in the head of pancreas. This is gallbladder. This is liver. This is the serocystic neoplasm in the head of pancreas. If you are not able to appreciate the cyst features very clearly in a CT scan, you can always do an MRI. The MRI gives the better image of the cystic lesion. It clearly shows the internal architecture of the cystic lesion. Whereas CT will show its relationship to the blood vessel, its relationship to the adjacent structures. But if you want to clearly delineate the architecture of a cystic lesion, MRI is more superior than CT scan. But if you compare CT, MRI, and endo ultrasound is always far superior than compared to your cross-sectional imaging because you can also do a cystic fluid analysis. See the spongy appearance of serocystic neoplasm in the head of pancreas. Okay. See the spongy appearance of cystic neoplasm in the tail of pancreas. If you are not able to appreciate, you can also do an MRI. And we have several subtypes of serocystic neoplasm, like microcystic variant and macrocystic variant. If it is a macrocystic SCN, we have to differentiate between what is the differential diagnosis for macrocystic SCN? Mucinous cystic neoplasm. For microcystic SCN only, the differential diagnosis is branch duct IPMN because it both looks similar. Okay, for macrocystic, you should compare with the macrocystic lesion. Other macrocystic lesion is mucinous cystic neoplasm. Okay. Then this is another subtype, VHL associated serocystic neoplasm and serocystadino carcinoma. Malignant potential is determined only by the presence of metastasis. SCNs are benign tumors, they can be observed. Okay. Indication for surgery in serocystic neoplasm or whether it is symptomatic or not, when cyst is more than 4 cm or when you are not able to characterize this as a serocystic neoplasm. Serocystic neoplasm can be generally managed conservatively. Only when it is symptomatic, you have to intervene. Okay, size criteria is not very strict. 1 minute. Okay, so SCNs or benign can be observed. Indication for resection is only when the tumor is symptomatic. When cyst is more than 4 cm is a soft indication. Symptomatic tumors alone are resected. So as a final point in SCN, they are benign tumors, more common in the grandmother age. They are multilocated, which means more than 6 microcysts, which are less than 2 cm. Small, numerous cysts will be there in serocystic neoplasm like this. Small, numerous cysts. Then honeycomb appearance or spongy appearance, you can say. Treatment is to observe only when it is symptomatic to operate. So,
if there is a large serocystic neoplasm in the head of pancreas which is producing gastric outlet obstruction, If it is causing should be done.
Symptom, yes, if it is causing symptom, you should use Whipple's.
My question is, should a Whipple be done or a gastrogesenostomy?
Whipple.
Okay. Yes.
See, sir, so why Whipple, sir?
Even though it's a benign condition, there is no protocols to do only drainage procedure. It has not been described in literature. It's always to research.
Can invocation suffice for SCN?
I don't understand. What?
Can enucleation suffice for an SCN?
No. Invocation is not advised. Either do distal pancreatectomy or Whipple's. Okay. For enucleation, the tumor should be very small. Okay. Very
okay,
small, it's not going to cause any symptoms.
Right, sir. Thank you, sir.
So what about the recurrence, sir, after aspiration of, suppose?
It will always recur. If you aspirate, it will recur. Because it is lined by cubital epithelium, it is going to secrete fluid, it will always recur.
So the wall thickness, as you said before, it's always less than 2 millimeters, sir.
It's not always less than 2 mm. It is a thin walled cyst. That is what I mean to say.
Okay, sir.
See, this is one of our patients who has a cystic lesion in the tail of pancreas. We couldn't do an MRI in this patient, so we did an endo ultrasound. Endo ultrasound showed CA level of 0.48. CA level, how much indicates mesenocystic neoplasm?
192.
More than 192 indicates mesenocystic neoplasm. It's very, very low. So it is not mesenocystic neoplasm. So we are convinced that it is a serocystic neoplasm. And it is not causing symptom in this patient. So we manage this patient conservatively. Okay. Is there any doubt in serocystic neoplasm? No role for enucleation, no role for sclerotherapy. It is always resection when it is symptomatic.
Sir, what does it loculation mean, sir? Multiloculated.
It is because of the small cyst.
Okay.
So it is an conglomeration of small cyst.
Okay, sir.
We'll go for MCN. Mucinocystic neoplasm. They are unilocular and macrocystic. Whereas serocystic neoplasm is multilocular and microcystic. Small cysts and multiple cysts are there. Here it is unilocular and macrocystic. They do not communicate with the pancreatic duct. And here the cyst fluid is thick and rich in mucin. Okay. See, this is a huge cyst. Though multiple septations are there, you can see the thick mucin-filled cyst. Okay. And you can see the lining is by columnar epithelium. Whereas in serocystic neoplasm, it is cuboidal epithelium. Here it is columnar epithelium. Okay. See the huge cyst with mucin-filled cyst. Huge cyst in the tail of pancreas. So mucinocystic neoplasm is more common in the body and the tail. They have ovarian stroma. See here, ovarian stroma. And they stain positive for estrogen receptor, progesterone receptor, and alpha inhibin. So the ovarian stroma stains positive for all these. And epithelial cells strain for, you can clearly write CEA and CA99. They also strain for CK7, C18 and 19. From these areas, questions have not been asked so far. So these are all possible areas to ask questions in the next exam. Okay. So what are the receptors and what are the stains possible in mucinocystic neoplasm? What is the immutation causing mucinocystic neoplasm?
Genus.
RNF-43. Very good. So, mucinocystic neoplasm has 20% chance of invasive carcinoma. MCN, 20% chance of invasive carcinoma. Mucinocystic neoplasm, RNF-43 is the most common mutation. Whereas IPMN, genus, RNF-43 and KRAS. So, CT finding in mucinocystic neoplasm, they are oval lesion. They have an identifiable wall. Fewer than 6 loculations. Loculations are more than 2 centimeters. So unilocular macrocystic, you can read that way. It does not communicate with the main pancreatic duct. See, this is a body lesion with the unilocular peripheral calcification. See this body lesion with internal septation. This is the classical appearance for biliary cystadenoma also, okay, because it is also called as MCML, right? So a unilocular larger lesion with internal septation, you call it as mucinous cystic neoplasm. Sometimes they can also have solid component, that is called as mural nodule. See the septations, large lesion with internal septation, it is mucinous cystic neoplasm. Treatment, resection, all MCN should be removed considering the malignant potential, 20% chance of malignancy. Surgery depends on the location. Head, you do pancreatic adenectomy. Body and tail, you do a distal pancreatectomy. You do splenectomy if there is suspicion of malignancy. Okay. The lymphadenectomy should always be done. So this is one of the resected mucinous cystic neoplasm. Any doubt in mucinous cystic neoplasm? Okay, we'll go for IPM. IPM, and you should understand, it is only the abnormality of the duct. Okay, if it is a main duct IPM, you will not find any cyst in the main duct IPM. You will see only the dilated main pancreatic duct. The dilated main pancreatic duct can be either focal or diffuse. Like the entire pancreatic duct, the entire pancreatic duct can be dilated, or only the part of the pancreatic duct can be dilated. Can be either focal or diffuse. This is about main duct IPM. Think that main duct IPM and only the duct will be abnormal. You will not see any cyst. Don't confuse it. Okay. So they are more common in men. IPM is more common in men. This is given in Shackelford, whereas in Sabiston it is given in male and female are equal. Okay. So we will take what is given in Shackelford. It is more common in men. And it is more common in older individuals with peak incidence between 60 and 70 years. And MD-IPMN occurs in 25% of patients, and BD-IPMN is more common, 57%, and mixed in 18%. Okay. So BD-IPMN is more common, but risk of malignancy is more with MD-IPMN. Okay. Now comes the important points we will discuss from here on. So approximately 30 to 40% of resected IPMNs harbor an invasive adenocarcinoma, and adenocarcinoma is more strongly associated with main duct IPMN. So main duct IPMN has more chance of malignancy. Approximately half of invasive carcinoma arising with IPMNs are so-called colloid carcinomas, and most of the remainder are tubular adenocarcinomas. So the most common malignancy is colloid carcinoma with IPMN.
So these are all subtypes of PDAC only?
All subtypes. We will go into the subtypes.
I mean to ask, these come under pancreatic ductal adenocarcinoma conversely.
Yeah. The adenocarcinoma, yes, which develops from the IPMN.
Yes.
Yes, these are all adenocarcinomas.
Yes.
Yes. So main duct IPMN will have a dilated main duct, which are mucin filled and more than 5 mm. They have fish mouth appearance on endoscopy. And head of pancreas is the most common location. Okay, so this is the fish mouth appearance or fish eye appearance. See the dilated pancreatic duct only in the body and the tail region. Compared to this duct, this is very much dilated. Okay, BD-IPMN, this occurs in younger age, they have less chance of malignancy. I put exclamatory marks because there are certain features which will say this has chance of malignancy. That is called as worrisome features and high risk features that we are going to discuss. Then most common site is uncinate. It communicates with the pancreatic duct. What is the appearance? It's the bunch of grapes appearance. See a cystic neoplasm. To identify the ductal communication, you should do an MRI. Okay. So grape-like appearance, multicystic, mucin-filled appearance. Mucin-filled. So difference between SCN and BD-IPMN are, ductal communication is present in SCN, whereas in BD-IPMN it is absent. And it is more common in males. Okay, whereas serous cystic neoplasm is more common in females. You can see the ductal communication here in this BD-IPMN. So the ductal communication with this cystic neoplasm. And this is an endos ultrasound showing a neural nodule within the cystic lesion, which is a high risk feature. Worrisome feature. So based on epithelial lining of the papillary component, we can divide the IPMN into four subtypes. This is given only in Shackelford. This is not in Sabiston. Now, questions are not asked in this part so far, so it is a potential area to ask questions in this area. What are the subtypes of IPMN? Gastric, intestinal, pancreatic or biliary, and oncocytic. We have four subtypes. Okay, we will see in detail one by one. IPMN gastric type, they have a small basal nuclei and apical cytoplasmic mucin. They are low grade tumors. They express MUC5AC and MUC6. You remember this, what are the markers it is expressed for every subtype? Okay. And BDIPMN are predominantly gastric type and they have a better survival because they are low grade tumors. Okay. So BDIPMN gastric type, small basal nuclei, they are low grade, express MUC5AC and MUC6. BDIPMN are predominantly gastric type and they have better survival. So this is the gastric type of IPMN. Thick finger-like papillae resembling gastric fovea. They express MUC5AC. MUC5AC is expressed in all the subtypes. Okay. IPMN intestinal type. They have finger-like projection with mucinous cytoplasm with cigar-shaped nuclei. Express MUC5AC and MUC2. MUC2 and CDX2 are specific for intestinal subtype. It will not be expressed in any other subtype of IPMN. It is associated with choroid carcinoma. MGIPMN are intestinal type. BDIPMN are gastric type. MDIPMN are intestinal type. See the mucin-filled cytoplasm and the cigar-shaped nuclei. Okay, they express MEC2. MEC2 is expressed only in intestinal subtype of IPMN. Next comes the pancreatic biliary type. They have cuboidal cells with atypical nuclei and prominent nuclei. They are high-grade tumors. They are associated with tubular carcinoma, which are high-grade and aggressive. Okay. Next comes, this is the pancreatic biliary type, consisted of arborescent complex phone-like papillae resembling cholangiocarcinoma. Carcinoma. Okay. MUC1 is expressed here. Then IPMN oncocytic type. These cells will have eosinophilic cytoplasm due to abundant mitochondria. Eosinophilic cytoplasm due to abundant mitochondria. They express MUC1 and MUC6. They have arborescent papillary and cribriform formation. They call it as fractal-shaped papilla with eosinophilic cell. What is this fractal shape? So this is the base. So it is a rougher fragmented geometric shape that can be split into parts, each of which is a reduced copy of the whole. Okay, this is the primary shape. When you, whatever you construct, the primary shape is the same. This is called as fractal shape. Okay, so this is one important tabular column. It is not given in any of the books. I will refer it from some other book. MUC5AC is seen in all the type subtypes. Okay, whereas MUCT2 is seen only in the intestinal subtype. MUC1 is seen in the high-grade tumors, high-grade subtypes, which are pancreatic biliary and oncocytic subtypes. Okay. This is the most important. You see this MUCT expression. MUC2 expression is seen only in intestinal subtype. Intestinal type alone express MUC2. Okay. Then mutations. You see this. Interestingly, yes.
Sorry, any clinical use is there by knowing the subtypes?
By knowing the subtypes, there is no clinical use as of now.
Okay, sir.
You can predict this patient will have a poor prognosis or like that. Like if you have a pancreatic biliary IPMN, you will have a poor prognosis.
Okay.
As of now, they have started describing the experience.
Okay.
So, interestingly, correlations between phenotypic differentiation of IPMN and mutation have been identified. Right? If there is a GNS mutation, it is more common in gastric and intestinal. You remember G for gastric, N for intestinal. Okay, GNS mutation is more common in gastric and intestinal type of IPMN than in pancreatic biliary type IPMN. Whereas KRAS are more common in gastric and pancreatic biliary. KRAS is more common in gastric and pancreatic biliary subtype. Okay, how this mutation is going to help me in the diagnosis? Like I can do a cyst fluid, aspirate endo ultrasound, I can aspirate the cyst fluid and I can use the cyst fluid for mutation testing. If there is GNAS mutation, I will suspect GNAS or KRAS mutation, I will suspect IPM. Understood? Mutation, in the cyst fluid itself, I can look for GNAS mutation and KRAS mutation. If I can identify that mutation, it indicates IPMN. Okay?
Okay.
Yes. What is the treatment of IPMN? The treatment is different for MD-IPMN and BD-IPMN. First, MD-IPMN. It can do a resection, pancreatic duodenectomy or a duodenal pancreatectomy, frozen section of the margin, or you can do a total pancreatectomy. This is called a creeping resection, we will see in clear. BD-IPMN can be observed. Surgery depends on certain high-risk features and worrisome features that we discuss. Mixed IPMN, you treat it as MD-IPMN. Okay. See here. This is the management of MD and mixed IPMN. Mixed IPMN, you see this tabular column. Management of MD-IPMN and mixed type IPMN. When there is complete involvement of the main pancreatic duct, when the whole pancreatic duct is involved, what you should do? Total pancreatectomy. Okay. When there is partial involvement of the main pancreatic duct, you can do a partial pancreatectomy and frozen section margin. You should do, like, if suppose the head of the pancreas is involved, you can do a Whipple's procedure and then do a frozen section. Okay. If frozen section is negative or low grade dysplasia, you need not extend the resection. If frozen section is moderate grade dysplasia or severe grade dysplasia, you should extend the resection margin further. Okay. That is the discussion. Then this is about branch duct IPMN. We have high risk features and worrisome features which are discussed for the branch duct IPMN. So, if these features are present, I will do an endoscopic ultrasound. If high risk features are present, I will consider surgery. This is a simple management. If I have a branch duct IPMN diagnosed with patient having an obstructive jaundice or an enhancing mural nodule more than 5 mm or an MPD more than 10 mm, this has high chance of malignancy, then I will consider surgery in this case. Okay. Worrisome features, like when this, you have a totally 9 features, 1 clinical and 8 imaging features. Okay. 1 clinical feature is pancreatitis, that is not given here. Then 8 imaging features are all given here. 8 imaging features, 8 other features are 3 in the cyst, 2 in the duct, and remaining are outside the duct. Okay. See this. Cyst features, cyst more than 3 cm, enhancing mural nodule less than 5 mm, and enhancing cyst wall. These are 3 cyst features. 2 ductal features, main duct 5 to 9 mm, and abrupt change in the caliber of the pancreatic duct with distal pancreatic atrophy. These are 2 ductal features. Outside the duct, it is lymphadenopathy. Okay. Then 2 other features are increased level of CA19-9 and cyst growth rate more than 5 mm for 2 years. So these are all worrisome features. When worrisome features are there, I will do an endo ultrasound. Okay. After doing an endo ultrasound, if I find that the mural nodule is more than 5 mm. Okay, it is more specific than a cross-sectional imaging, right? So after doing an endo ultrasound, if I see that mural nodule is more than 5 mm, and when there is suspicion of main duct involvement or cytology suspicion or positive for malignancy, you consider surgery. This is the algorithm for management of BD-IPM. Okay. I will discuss again in that. Then this is combining all the cystic neoplasm, the diagnostic evaluation. We have non-invasive modalities and invasive modalities. In non-invasive, we have MDCT. What are the serocystic neoplasm? What are the imaging findings? Fine external lobulation. They are microcystic, multilocular, central scar, central calcification. Mucinous cystic neoplasm, they are oval, macrocystic, mostly unilocular, occasionally multilocular. Peripheral axial calcification, mural nodule will be there. Okay. So this is the case of microcystic serocystic neoplasm with central calcification. This is mucinous cystic neoplasm, large multilocular, located in the body of region with internal septation like this. Okay. This is mucinous cystic neoplasm. There are certain findings in the imaging which can say that this is more likely malignant, like presence of mural nodule, septal enhancement, calcification, vascular encasement, biliary obstruction, ascites. All this is suggest malignant mucinous cystic neoplasm. This is IPMN we have seen previously itself. This is side branch IPMN, where you have to demonstrate ductal communication with the help of MRI. This is another side branch IPMN. MRCP will help in ductal communication, and also it helps in better delineation of the internal architecture of the cyst. You see this fine external lobulation and central stellate scar is better appreciated in this MRI rather than a CT scan. Okay. See, this is a large tumor located in the body region with internal septation like this. Its internal architecture is clearly defined with this. This is mucinous cystic neoplasm. This is an IPMN showing a dilated pancreatic duct. Okay. this is a branched-duct IPMN, which is communicating with the pancreatic duct. For branched-duct IPMN diagnosis, you should always do an MRI. Okay, so this is another branched-duct IPMN. PET-CT, there is no role for PET-CT as of now for cystic neoplasm of pancreas. Then we have invasive imaging modalities like EUS, cyst morphology and cystic fluid analysis. The main role of EUS is the cystic fluid analysis.
One quick doubt. For every such patient who comes, either symptomatic or asymptomatic, we get a screening ultrasound of the abdomen done, right? I mean, we start off practically speaking. If we are suspecting a cystic problem in the pancreas, why not straight away go for an MRI, why CT?
If we can diagnose the mucinous cystic neoplasm in CT itself, why should we go for an MRI?
I'm sorry, sir. Your voice is breaking, sir.
If I can diagnose mucinous cystic neoplasm in the CT scan itself.
Okay.
Why should I do need an MRI? Just because to see the internal architecture.
Yes,
and
sir.
And CT also gives its relationship to the vessels.
Sir, if on MRI you are getting to know that it is a serous cystic neoplasm, where you can see the architecture better, you know that it is most likely a benign problem. You may just conserve the patient and not operate if he's asymptomatic. However, on MRI, if you can delineate that if it's a mucinous cystic neoplasm, there is more chance of malignancy, you might plan to operate.
Yes. For planning surgical strategy, CT is more better than an MRI. That's why you always do a CT scan first.
So from MCQ point of view, investigation of choice for cystic neoplasm of the pancreas would be?
Endo-ultrasound.
Endo-ultrasound. And if that is not there in the option then?
If it is not there an option, and you can do an MRI.
Then MRI is better. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
So endo-ultrasound, the main role is not to do the cyst fluid analysis. It is to identify the internal architecture of the cyst. Internal architecture of the cyst, how does it look like? Soap bubble or spongy appearance, right? This is seen in serous cystic neoplasm. The main function of endo-ultrasound is to identify the internal architecture. Cyst fluid analysis is the second advantage of doing an endo-ultrasound. See this appearance, microcyst. You can see the microcyst. Right? This is serous cystic neoplasm.
Internal architecture is also seen by MRI, no, sir?
MRI can also think, yes. But endo-ultrasound is superior to MRI.
Okay, sir. Just because in taking fluid analysis.
Yes, we are also doing a fluid analysis, and internal architecture is even better, better analyzed than an MRI.
Okay, sir.
Okay. You can see the mural nodule in this endo-ultrasound. You can also assess the vascularity of this mural nodule. And this is IPMN. The ductal communication can all well identified with this endo-ultrasound. So this you are all very clear about this. You need not discuss about this. So what is this tumor in the tail of pancreas?
MCM. It's
solid and cystic component. Solid and cystic component. There is no septation. It is only solid and cystic component. Other. These are all solid. These are all cystic. It occurs in a young female.
SPT.
Solid pseudopapillary tumor. So this is how the tumor looks like. These are all cystic degeneration. This is not a true cyst. These are all cystic degeneration. Okay. So we have completed all the diagnostic modalities. Now we are going for solid pseudopapillary tumor. It's also called as Franz tumor or Hammersley tumor. 3% of all pancreatic tumors is SPT. 6-12% of all cystic neoplasms. Serological tests are not useful. You don't do a CA19, CA level, not useful. Only 15% asymptomatic. It means 85% of the patients are symptomatic. The most common symptom is abdominal pain. Okay, 85% of patients with SPT are symptomatic. Imaging, you will find a large cyst, heterogeneously enhancing lesion with solid and cystic component, and with the peripheral enhancement and central calcification can also be seen. Solid and cystic component is the criteria for diagnosing solid pseudopapillary tumor. And these are not true cysts because it is due to cystic degeneration, necrosis. They are more common in the tail. They occur in the younger age group. Pathology-wise, they have branching papillary fronds and grooved nuclei. Remember, grooved nuclei alone, grooved nuclei. These are branching papilla. You can see the grooved nuclei here. This is very important. Immunophenotype stain positive for neuron-specific enolase, CD10, dementin, beta-catenin, and progesterone receptor is positive here also. In Shackle-4, they are mentioned estrogen receptor is also seen in few cases. I think in page number 1174, they have mentioned that. Then alpha-methyl-acyl-CoA racemase is also positive. Okay. So these are the immunophenotype stains. NSE, CD10, Vimentin, chromogranin is not seen. Okay. Beta-catenin will be seen. Progesterone receptor stain will be positive. And AMACR will also be positive. Most important is beta-catenin and progesterone receptor positivity. And some area, they have mentioned CD56 also. In Blumgard, they have mentioned CD56 also. So to this list, you can add CD10 and CD56. Okay. They are neuroendocrine markers, CD56 synaptophysin. But chromogranin is not expressed in these tumors. See, these are all beta-catenin positive cells seen in solid pseudocapillary tumor. This is our own patient, the large tumor in the tail of pancreas with solid and cystic component. Genetics, alteration in the beta-catenin pathway due to mutation in CTNNB1. There is nuclear accumulation of beta-catenin noted in 95% of the patients. Okay. It has 50% chance of metastasis. Treatment is surgery, no role for adjuvant therapy. Okay. So see how the one of our own patient we have resected. See how it looks like cut pomegranate appearance. No? So now we have the questions all ready for the final session. Please come forward and answer.
Yes.
And sunburst calcification is seen in?
SCN.
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 Very good. Very good. Pancreatic cyst with high amylase level.
MCN.
IPMN.
IPMN.
Why MCN?
IPMN.
IPMN. So pancreatic cyst with high amylase level is IPMN. High amylase level when there is ductal communication, high CA is seen in mucinous cystic neoplasm and IPMN. They are high chance of malignancy. Okay. Okay. So see here, serous cystic neoplasm is given evenly distributed. But where it is given is head of pancreas is the most common.
So in the text, it's given it's more common in the head of the pancreas, in the sabestrin itself.
Sabestrin, the text is given.
Text given. Okay. Even when we stayed prepared for the entrance exam, we thought it is head only. So we will take head is the most common location of serous cystic neoplasm. What is the most common location for IPMN?
Head,
the IPMN branching is
head. Both are head.
Both are head.
Both are head only. Okay, most common location is head. But I want you to make a change in this. Males are the most, in males, have the high risk of development of IPMN as given in Shackle-4. Okay. But if you want to look at Blumgard, they again say equal incidence. Okay.
Oh.
So, IPMN is more common in males. That is what is given in Shackle-4. So we will make a change in this. IPMN is more common in males. Okay. So serous cystic neoplasm, most common location?
Head.
Head. Mucinous?
Body and tail.
MD-IPMN?
Head.
Head. Head.
Uncinate. Uncinate, yes. So, occurs in which age?
Grandmother.
Yes, senior age. Sunburst calcification is seen in?
20%.
20%.
See? Then in some other book, it is mentioned as 30%. So I think this is Shackle-4. 30%. Okay. What is the diagnosis?
MCN.
Mucinous.
Large with internal septation, it is mucinous cystic neoplasm. What is some and high-risk features were described for?
BDIPMN.
This is given in Shackle-Sabestrin. Please don't follow this. These are all older versions. This is also older version. Please don't follow this. This is the latest version. We have seen high-risk features are obstructive jaundice, enhancing neural nodule more than 5 mm, and MTD dilatation more than 10 mm. These two features also come in worrisome features. It is not Fukuoka.
Coca-Cola.
I think W will come in. Enhancing neural nodule more than 5 mm and MPD more than 10 mm. These two features will also come in the Orison features also, but modified. Enhancing neural nodule less than 5 mm here and MPD is 5 to 9 mm here. Okay. See the clinical and imaging. I told you, no, clinical features pancreatitis and imaging you have 8 criteria. Okay. It is not strictly imaging. Serum CA99 level is not an imaging criteria. And cyst growth rate is more than 5 mm for 2 years. Should also be taken into account. When you have the Orison features, you should do an endoscopic ultrasound. If endoscopic ultrasound shows a neural nodule more than 5 mm, or main duct suspicious of involvement, or cytology suspicious or positive for malignancy, you should do surgery. Otherwise, you can follow up the cyst. Depending on the size of the cyst, you can do an imaging. The imaging frequency differs and the type of imaging also differs. Okay. So when it is more than 3 cm, close surveillance with MRI. 2 to 3 cm, it is an endo ultrasound. For 1 cm or 1 to 2 cm, you can do a CT and MRI. Okay. So this is what again about BDI payment. High risk features, Orison features. Definitely one question will be asked out of this. So which of the following is not a Orison feature?
MD more than 1 cm.
More than 3
cm. MD more than
1 cm. First option, you see, main duct more than 1 cm. It is a high risk feature.
High risk feature.
Okay. Cyst more than 3 cm is a Orison feature. See here. Okay.
Okay.
So incidence of malignancy in MDI PMN?
30%.
Individuals with MDI PMN have a 30 to 50% risk of harboring invasive pancreatic cancer at the time of presentation. IPMN are more common in?
Head of the pancreas.
Head of the pancreas. CA level in cystic neoplasm of pancreas.
Does not predict invasive malignancy.
Yes. It indicates it is a mucinous reaction. That's all. CA level more than 192 is the cutoff. Okay. The previously healthy 79-year-old woman presents with early satiety and abdominal fullness. CT scan of the abdomen reveals a cystic lesion in the body and tail of pancreas. CT guided aspiration demonstrates an elevated CEA level. So of the following is the most appropriate treatment option for this patient. What is the diagnosis? This
MCN.
MCN. MPL. What is the treatment for MCN?
Distal pancreatectomy.
Distal pancreatectomy.
Distal pancreatectomy.
She is 80-year-old. We will proceed with surgery.
If she tolerates surgery, we can do. Otherwise, we can do surgery.
Yeah.
Okay.
So otherwise, tolerate surgery. Otherwise, we can.
Just best supportive care.
Okay, sir.
What is the mutation?
RNF43.
Very good. So, a 60-year-old woman was referred to the clinic to discuss an incidental finding of cystic lesion in the head of pancreas while undergoing CT thorax and abdomen for assessment of a thyroid gland. She went on to have an endoscopic ultrasound with biopsy. This together with the CT confirmed a serous cystic tumor. Which of the CT finding is pathognomonic of pancreatic serous cystic tumor?
E.
Very good. What is the treatment of the serous cystic neoplasm? C is asymptomatic.
Observation.
Gastric type of IPMN is more common with?
BD IPMN.
Which of the following stains negative in SPT?
ER positive.
ER positive, it is negative. See this. These are the stains positive in SPT. MUCT2 is positive in which subtype of IPMN?
Intestinal.
Intestinal type. Very good. See, MUCT2 is seen only in the intestinal subtype. MUC1 is seen in both pancreatobiliary and oncocytic subtype. So, IPMN subtype associated with colloid carcinoma?
Intestinal.
Intestinal subtype associated with colloid carcinoma. IPM and subtype associated with tubular carcinoma?
Pancreatobiliary.
Pancreatobiliary. Tubular carcinoma has worse prognosis. Pancreatobiliary is a high grade type. Okay. Tubular carcinoma. Sir, high grade and aggressive.
So tubular carcinoma is a different entity, sir, apart from the adenocarcinoma and colloid carcinoma.
It is a subtype of adenocarcinoma.
Right.
Like when you have a cerebral breast, you have several types, no?
Yes, sir. Okay.
Similar to that. Next. A 45-year-old woman is evaluated for epigastric and back pain. Physical examination is normal. CT of the abdomen reveals an 8-centimeter cystic lesion in the region of tail of pancreas. This is demonstrate internal septation and papillary projection. What is the diagnosis?
MCM.
SPT.
Okay. SPT. Look at the age.
MCM. MCM.
MCM. Yes.
The papillary projection.
That is the ovarian mural nodule. If you see the gross feature of the MCN, it has some small papillary projection from its wall.
Okay.
Yeah.
Otherwise, papillary projections is meant for SPT, no, sir?
Yes. More commonly, huge papillary projections are seen in SPT.
Okay.
Okay. 70-year female with abdominal pain. You should see the age in this question, previous question. You should see the age.
Sir.
Okay. So, 70-year female present with abdominal pain. Cross-section image shows 4-centimeter lesion in the head of pancreas. Next step, what will you do? CT or MRI has already been done, which shows as a cystic lesion.
US.
To characterize it better, that's all. IPMN, all are true except.
Enucleation.
Enucleation is a record.
You will not do an enucleation. Very good. Trans tumor, all are true except.
Granin positive.
Yes, chromogranin is negative. Very good. Pin, all are true except. More common in women, mean age is 25 years, 15% malignant, 80%
asymptomatic. 80% asymptomatic. Yeah, yes. 15% asymptomatic.
85% is symptomatic. Correct. Genetic analysis of IPMN, which of the following is true? SMAD4 are more common than adenocarcinoma. Genus have been found in more than 70% of IPMN. Genus mutation are more common in gastric and pancreatic. Is it true?
No, sir.
Gastric and intestinal. Very good. So it is false. KRAS mutation are more common in gastric and intestinal. Is it true?
No.
It is seen in gastric and pancreatobiliary IPM.
Okay.
Okay. Genus have been found in more than 70% of IPM. Is it true?
Yes.
IPMNs have most common mutations genus, right? It is B is correct, A is wrong. Okay. See, genus is more, has been found in more than 70% of IPMNs. Okay?
Okay.
That's all. Over for the day.